My name is Owen Fiss. I have two distinctions. One is that I teach at the law school, and the second one is that I'm a good friend of Lamin Sanneh. Indeed, I met him and welcomed him to the campus when he first came in 1989. So it's a particular pleasure and honor for me to orchestrate this event. Lamin, as I think all of you know, is one of the adornments, one of the jewels of the university. He's a professor in the Divinity School and a professor in the History Department. He's also an internationally recognized expert on Christianity and Islam and world religions and the relationships between them. Lamin was born in the Gambia. He received his early education there. Higher education, I think, was at the University of Birmingham and the Near East School of Theology in Beirut. And eventually, he received his PhD from the University of London in Islamic history. He's taught at a great variety of institutions, including the University of Ghana, University of Aberdeen, and Harvard. But of course, his most distinguished appointment is here at Yale. And he's been a professor at the university, as I said, since 1989. He's published hundreds of articles and scores of books. And his most recent book, Beyond Jihad, was published, I think officially just days ago,
yes.
just days ago by Oxford University Press. And it's really an outstanding book, and I think will be hailed by all the critics and commentators. I'm going to soon turn the floor over to Lamin, who will talk about the book for about 15 or 20 minutes. Then we have two commentators, world fellows for this year, Sughra, Ahmed, and Kanbar, Hossein-bor, who will speak hopefully for 10 or 15 minutes, and then we will turn the floor over to you for questions and comments. But before I turn the floor over to Lamin, I'm going to add, if he'll forgive me, one more additional biographical fact about him. Lamin was born into an Orthodox Islamic family. Reading the Quran, studying the Quran, he became curious about Christianity. Remarkably, he decided, I gather from published interviews rather quietly, something he didn't share with his teachers or his schoolmates, he decided to convert to Christianity. And today, he is a member of the Catholic Church. And he became a member of the Catholic Church only after considerable, I would say, suspicion and resistance to his conversion. But this particular feature of his life, I think, uniquely qualifies him to speak about the relationship between Christianity and Islam. And that's why, over the years, he's become a central figure in the dialogue between these two great religious traditions. Amen.
Thank you very much, Owen, for your kind and really too generous words. I think I should stand here so my voice can carry. I'm not very good at projecting my voice. We are gathered here reminds me of what the clerics I studied would call hijra, a little withdrawal, separating ourselves for a brief moment to undertake a period of reflection, to basically retire from routine and everyday distractions of life, so that we can turn our minds to something slightly different and emerge from it refreshed, hopefully. I'm really honored and delighted that all of you are here. I know it's a very busy time of the calendar of life at Yale, so I'm really very appreciative and gratified by your presence, and indeed by Owen's willingness to be the MC for this occasion. And I'm very grateful to our two respondents, Sughra, Ahmed, and Kanbar, for their wonderful, rather alack willingness to jump in at a time when the book was still rather unformed. I mean, I think they received a PDF file of the book without the convenience of a bound thesis. And I look forward very much to our conversation. But I want to say just a few words about Beyond Jihad. It was a long time coming. I at first was very incredulous of the idea of a pacifist tradition in Islam. And one of the things I did basically was to cover the bases. And I undertook a journey where I visited and corresponded with scholars around the world to really ask them to tell me whether this is a viable idea. And then I undertook work in the archives and then went on a field trip in Senegal, the Gambia, and beyond. And actually, the field trip continued when we lived in Ghana and Sierra Leone and Nigeria as well. So it's a very long time developing this thesis, this idea of a pacifist tradition in Islam. My Arab friends, I have to tell you, were equally incredulous about whether there is such a thing as a pacifist tradition in Islam. And one of the problems I encountered in the field was that the manuscripts that I was tracking existed only in family libraries and archives. Here is one page from one of these chronicles. And the paper is very thin and breaks and disintegrates at the edges. So it's very difficult to just take one chronicle and get a full picture of the history that I was interested in. So I had to collect a number of these chronicles, including one rather belatedly in the University of Ghana, Institute of African Studies, which had a chronicle written by the Maliki Mufti of Bobo-Dioulasso in Burkina Faso, accessioned in the university library. Ivor Wilkes looked at the manuscript, but no one was able to really identify it. And lo and behold, this manuscript is actually very important to show the influence of this pacifist tradition throughout West Africa. And then I have a photograph at the end here of an interview scene. The guy I was interviewing was very adamant about, almost agitated, when I asked the question in a public setting whether pacifism was really viable in Islam. And he nearly dropped his piece of paper to say, well, look, we followed this tradition for 700 years. And you cannot point to one jihad movement that has lasted more than just a few years. So our vindication is that this heritage has persisted and survived for centuries across a good deal of West Africa. And the library of these people was in a very sad state of conservation, the papers moldy, disintegrating. They keep their books in metal boxes, and with the humidity, of course, that really wreaks havoc on this intellectual heritage. Some clerics in Senegal have proper libraries that are properly ventilated, and that helps to preserve some of these books and manuscripts. I had a visitor from Senegal a few years ago who visited me at the Divinity School, and I showed him this chronicle, this manuscript, and he was amazed. He said, I never expected to come to Yale to find evidence of my heritage that I didn't know when I lived in Senegal, which is, again, very sad state of affairs. So I'm hoping eventually to really gather these chronicles and have them cataloged and available for other researchers to use. The book itself, let me just say a few words about the structure of the book. The centerpiece for the interpretation of the spread of Islam in West Africa is the Almoravid conquest of Ghana. The Almoravids, of course, were very prominent. We know a great deal about them from their history in Spain and the Spanish Empire they created in the 11th century. And that is the way historians have started to basically expound the history of Islam in West Africa. And it gave historians two themes with which to play with the idea of the expansion of Islam. One is jihad, which was seen as necessary, and the other is syncretism, which jihad remedies and corrects. So you have these two poles, jihad and syncretism. And what I did in the first part of the book was really to use historical sources and dismantle the jihad hypothesis completely. There is no reference in Arabic, contemporary Arabic sources that the Almoravids conquered Ghana. A slight, almost reserved reference to it comes from Ibn Khaldun writing in the late 14th century. But even he is careful not to say that the Almoravids conquered Ghana. And so why did this thesis take off so powerfully? Well, that may be another story. But that part of the Almoravid conquest of Ghana can be counterbalanced by the story in Al-Bakri, writing in the 11th century, about how the Empire of Mali, which succeeded the Empire of Ghana, converted to Islam. And Al-Bakri gives a fairly detailed account of how drought afflicted the Kingdom of Mali, and the king was desperate for rain and tried his shrine priest to pray for rain, and they failed. So there was a visiting Muslim cleric in the kingdom, and to whom he turned for prayer for rain, Salat al-Istisqa in Arabic. And this cleric prayed for rain, downpour resulted, and the king converted. There's no drama in this conversion. There's no violence whatsoever. Mali became perhaps the most successful Muslim empire in West Africa. And we know a great deal of the history of Mali from the pilgrimage of Mansa Musa, who went on pilgrimage to Mecca in 1324. Mansa Musa was an erudite scholar of Maliki law, and his Arab hosts in Cairo were very complimentary about his devotion to religion, but also his devotion to learning, to scholarship. Mansa Musa was also very wealthy. He took so much gold with him to Cairo that he caused an inflation in Cairo, in the economy, which lasted for at least 50 years, because Ibn Khaldun, writing in the late 14th century, said that the signs of this inflation were evident even in his own time. He was a very powerful king, and yet Mansa Musa never embarked on jihad, never. He introduced Middle Eastern architectural styles in the Kingdom of Mali. He had architects come from North Africa to help build the great mosque of Timbuktu. Timbuktu, by the way, was a city of scholars where rulers were prevented from entering except once a year in Ramadan to pay tribute to the religious scholars of the city and to ask for their prayers. So it provided sanctuary from politics. And there were many, many centers like this throughout Mali. So the point I want to make then is that the transition of Mali from being a non-Muslim to becoming a Muslim empire was actually quite peaceful. The clerics I studied emerged from Mali from the 11th, 12th century. By the way, they're still there. They're still practicing peaceful forms of Islam. The centerpiece of the book is this clerical history, the emergence of this clerical core. And then in the final part of the book, I try to engage the wider intellectual tradition in Islam. We in the United States are very concerned, talk a great deal about Sharia. We regard Sharia as an intolerant, bigoted, violent form of Islam. If you look at the history of Sharia, the founders of Sharia, Imam Malik, the first legal compendium in Islam, Ash-Shafi, the colossus of Islamic law, Abu Hanifa, a real Enlightenment kind of figure, and Ibn Hanbal. All of them were persecuted by the rulers, by the caliphate. All of them were independent of the caliphate. Abu Hanifa was tortured and was bleeding in Baghdad in a prison, in a dungeon, where he was dumped by the ruler. And when the ruler found out that he hadn't died after 21 days of torture, he had his people poison him. And Abu Hanifa died, was murdered, really. And there was massive civil unrest in Baghdad against the caliph. Malik was also tortured. And Ibn Hanbal, the most conservative of the four legal schools in Sunni Islam, said that he detested the idea of receiving favors from the court, from the caliphate, and that it was what he calls an ordeal for him to be confronted with the attention that the court wanted to lavish on him. And he wrote, again, very strongly against associating with men of power. Shafi, he was in trouble in Baghdad, and it was Shaibani, his great student, who really, in some ways, was responsible for the creation of the Shafi'ite code in Islam, intervene to save him from further torture. So the point I want to make here is that Sharia is concerned mostly with the religious obligations of Muslims. Malik, his vast compendium, if you read it, it's really amazing, the attention he pays to prayer, what makes prayer valid, what makes it invalid, prayer at night, the festivals of Islam, Ramadan, the fast, the Lenten fast, and so forth, and regulations that help Muslims live the everyday life of a Muslim. Very little in Malik really about government as such. And you can say the same thing about Abu Hanifa. So I put all these together and I try to shed light on the clerical tradition of pacifism and argue that there is a lot in the Islamic intellectual tradition to favor, if you like, the idea of religion as an activity based in civil society. And that's really the key argument I make in the book. And so we, if you like, in the West, need to be aware of the importance and the significance of civil society and the way in which that can be strengthened and invested in, basically as an antidote also to a kind of radical sectarian interpretation of Islam. And I think in that connection, I should really emphasize something that I'm a little coy about it in the book, because I don't want to argue that James Madison is the frame for interpreting Islam today. My colleagues accuse me of trying to Americanize Islam, and my response, rather quick, is to say, well, worse things have happened to the religion, and that does not give me sleepless nights. But I do think that if you investigate the sources carefully, there seems to me a very important distinction Muslims want to make between religion and politics. Sufyan Thawri, the great jurist of Iraq, puts it as a kind of joke. The best rulers of the world, Sufyan Thawri says, are those who visit religious scholars. And the worst religious scholars are those who visit worldly rulers. Sufyan Thawri is saying in a very subtle way that religion and politics do mix and are intertwined. But when politics qualifies religion or moral norms, then politics becomes tyrannical and religion becomes hypocritical. But if the moral law qualifies politics as something contingent, something contrived, something that changes, there's nothing immutable about politics, it's full of ups and downs, then, Sufyan Thawri argues, it reduces, mitigates the tendency towards political despotism and political tyranny, and it allows religion to free itself of political expediency, and therefore religion can be true to itself. And I think this struggle between the religious scholars, the ulema, and the political rulers has really gone on through much of Islamic history. And it's a distinction, I think, that's important for the integrity of religion, but also for the integrity of politics. I should really stop here and look forward very much to the conversation from the respondents and to Owen's remarks.
Could I? I want to turn it over to our respondents in a second, but I want to just ask a question that comes off your very last comment. When we first met and started working on these issues, I was very struck by your conception of Islam's view about the relationship between, I think, church and state was the rubric we used then. And your view that you expressed at that point was that we shouldn't assume that Islam has the same view of the relationship between church and state that's assumed by Christianity and perhaps by James Madison, and that there was a kind of intractable, powerful connection between religion and politics in the Muslim world.
Yeah.
Now, I take your very last comment, to say that at least in West Africa, at least in the pre-modern period, there was a very clear distinction between politics and religion, and that this notion of politics and religion that we associate with Christianity, namely the separation of the two, was one of the primary themes of this pre-modern West African experience. And the question I ask is whether that this pre-modern experience you hold up now as a model for all Islam. And secondly, what happened, I mean, does it still exist in West Africa now, or has it collapsed and has the notion of the, shall we call it, the Islamic State, which fuses religion and politics, become prevalent in West Africa?
Yes, I think I should qualify what you remember so well, what I said earlier about the connection between religion and politics. I would say, and I'm open to correction, that Islamic thought is very careful not to reject the idea of social order, that Muslim scholars are more afraid of anarchy than they are of tyranny. No one, in their view, society is not viable. Society cannot survive without a political order. You need to, Al-Ghazali, for example, was very afraid of the idea of fitna, even though he supported the idea of hisba, which is amr bi ma'ruf wa nahi an al-munkar, translated as to commend the right and to discourage the wrong. That this function of making an ethical distinction, he believes, belongs in civil society. But civil society, people, Muslims who have this power, should not use it to rebel against society, against the majority. So that's that fear, that anarchy makes life intolerable or unlivable. It's very strong in Islam. But there's very little in the Quran really about the state as such. There's a great deal in the Quran about civil society, a religious civil society, in the sense of the ummah. The ummah is the community of faith. And the Quran itself says, I have created for you the ummatan wasatan, the middle community, that is free of the extremes of the left and the right, if you like. That the moral life is always a struggle at balancing what is feasible against what is laudable. And I think that is something that is alive and well in the Muslim world at large. The ulama, the religious scholars, have been co-opted by powerful political states, and in being co-opted, they've been corrupted. But the moral function of Islam is really vested in civil society, in the ummah. The Quran says almost nothing about the caliphate being in charge of this heritage. And from a very early age, from the 8th century, Muslim religious scholars treated the rulers as, well, they don't really take religion seriously. They play with it, a kind of sport, for their own short-term ends. But religion is really about our freedom to respond to the love of God. Said Qutb, who's been claimed as the standard flag bearer for the radicals, said something in his writing which is very important. He said that reverence for God should be a matter, if it is not in conscience, then becomes really impossible to carry. You can't have reverence for God if you don't have reverence in conscience. And we would say in America that the consent of the citizen is important for a liberal democracy. And the Muslims, and I think Christians, would say the conscience of the believer is similarly important for religious integrity. That if you really don't have a conscience, and religion is just calculation and expedience, then you politicize it, it becomes a political commodity. And I think this distinction, I think, is important for Islam's sense of itself as a revealed ethical system that came from God.
God is a 2016 World Fellow and the chairperson of the Islamic Society of Britain.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here this evening with you all, but especially on the occasion of the publication of this book by Professor Lamin Sanneh. I'd like to share with you a few words. If I can just load my page. About the notion of pacifism in Islam. But my reflection is going to really be on one of the things that you talked about towards the end there, Professor Sanneh, and that is about civil society. And for me, there's as a former head of a national Muslim organization in the UK and somebody who's been working in interfaith and intrafaith for quite some time now in the UK and Europe, for me, the question lies, how is pacifism and Islam being used today in modern civil society, particularly in the Western world, where I think we have a very different opportunity in how we understand, how we interpret, and how we encounter Islam as well as other faiths. So, for example, we have basic human rights which encourage us to think about freedom of religion and freedom of belief in a very different way to, say, for example, parts of the Middle East. And I think that's a very important thing for me. Now, one of the things that I'm quite passionate about and sort of take a lot of time thinking about is how to contextualize theology, how to make theology that is on the one hand depicted in a book, and if we think about Islam particularly, then the book and the word of Muhammad, but how can we make that relevant for today in terms of our own time and our own space? And so for me, religion is not a static thing. It's not something that can be held in a book or even in the example of an individual almost 1,500 years ago, and it still applies in every sense of the word to the time and space that we have today. It just doesn't work. And we can see that contradiction. The friction between the contradictions taking force in the Middle East through the examples of groups like, or extremists like Islamic State. So how is the whole sort of movement around contextual theology enabling people, and just to be fair, just the sort of sheer knowledge that common sense must prevail here, and that the rights of all of us are incredibly important, how does that translate into very public sentiments showing that Islam is very much in keeping with not just Western society, but a society that believes in democracy and human rights and liberal values and so on? So I want to give you some examples. Right here in the US, we've just a couple of days ago experienced a number of different events that have happened both in New York and in, my geography of the US is not great, but Massachusetts, where we've had stabbings, we've had exploding devices that are inexplicable. We don't know enough about them, but we do know in our own minds that they might be indicators of something, right? So well before that individual or those individuals are brought to trial, in our own minds, because of recent history particularly, we consider, well, actually, what could that be? And what, really, come on, let's be honest, what is that? Is it a terrorist? Is it an extremist? And if so, then what particular brand of theology do you think they follow? And it doesn't take us very long to come to the conclusion that actually perhaps they're Muslim extremists. And for me, personally, it's a sad state of where we are at today, both in terms of how people have interpreted religious ideology to mean something quite barbaric and something that doesn't make sense to the rest of us in the world, but also at the same time, the damage that it's done to the reputation of Islam and, of course, of Muslims. And my heart really goes out not just to the people of New York and Massachusetts, but also to Muslim communities that belong to the cultural groupings of the individuals who perpetrated those attacks. But actually, we also see a glimmer of hope and a glimmer of light in all sorts of different contexts around the world. But let me just focus on the Western side. So, for example, a few years ago, there was something called 100 Imams Statement. I don't know how many of you caught that. There are a number of statements that have been written and signed by scholars galore, and if you're involved within Muslim communities, actually it feels like they're coming out of our ears. But I can quite understand that if you're not involved in those sectors, then it feels as though the Muslim communities are almost silent. But that is not the case. So statements like the 100 Imam statements were used to say that this is not who we are, and we condemn this, and so on. I mean, you've heard the story many times, I'm sure. And then we also have really significant documents as far as the sort of interfaith arena is concerned. We had the Common Word a few years ago, where some of the more senior scholars of Islam gathered together to sign a statement that talked about the encouragement of Christian-Muslim engagement, particularly it was in response to a statement made by the Vatican quite some time ago, but we'd never seen something like this come forward from Muslim communities, and especially in a global context. So it was a very important document. And we recently had something called the Marrakesh Declaration, a very similar thing, but this time in the context of the world that we're living in, often which is quite violent and which promotes aggression and which promotes the idea of rarely peaceful means can achieve a win or a gain, but actually aggressive means can achieve a win or a gain in a political context. So it was a statement that sort of said that we all need to work together for a better tomorrow, and this is how we can do that, and it's not through war and it's not through aggression. Then we've seen many hundreds and thousands of people across the Western world and beyond, millions of people actually, vote with their feet. And so people have come out onto the streets of London, in Paris, various parts of the US, to actually demonstrate, not just talk about, but to actually show with their body, with their mind, that this is something that I don't agree with if we think about the anti-war marches. Iraq particularly comes to mind. And also people who again, with their feet, demonstrated that they are against very basic values that were taken for granted in our society, but that suddenly changed because our government changed its policies. So for example, in the UK, the bringing in of tuition fees for university education was a huge turning point that marked a very sad chapter in our lives. So again, you see Muslims and others coming out to talk about that in a very, very public way, and to the most recent example I can think of is the march just this last weekend on Saturday in London, where hundreds and thousands of people gathered together. Can anybody tell me what the issue was that they were marching against? Britain is one of the few countries in the Western world that has taken the fewest number of refugees and asylum seekers, and so thousands and thousands of people came to the streets of London on Saturday to say that we can do more, we want to do more, and we must do more. So demonstrative fashion, governments, policymakers, holders of power are being told by their people that this is not good enough and that we must do things differently. And Muslims are a part of that debate. And then there are lots of letters in the newspaper that Muslim communities come together and write and sign. So for example, We made the front page of the Observer a couple of years ago when the when ISIS sort of came about and called itself the Islamic State, and we wanted to make a very strong point that there's actually nothing stately about a group of extremists who plunder and murder, and there's certainly nothing religious about a group of people who behave in that way, despite what they might think, and that we mustn't give them the credence. Things have changed an awful lot since that time. And then you see Muslim communities very much integrated in their societies, especially in the UK, when you have award ceremonies that celebrate and mark the real contribution that Muslims have been making across the society, across sectors, religious and otherwise. And you also have festivals. So, for example, we have something called the Living Islam Festival, which brings together thousands upon thousands of Muslim families for a camping festival over a long weekend in a very wet, windy British countryside. That makes it a typical festival. No festival is complete in the UK without a bit of rain. And then you have the celebration of Muslims contributing to the cultural setting, cultural landscape, and the artistic setting of its nation. Now, and then I could talk about at length about leadership, especially gender equality and sexual equality, but I want to, knowing that time is short, I want to share with you just very briefly a couple of stories about other change makers historically. So what I'm talking about in the modern context, for me, are change makers and peacemakers, people who build great waves of change in a very peaceful, in a very collegiate fashion, which for diverse societies in a globalized world is absolutely essential, no matter who you are. And so I want to share with you a hadith, a story about the Prophet Muhammad. It's quite well known. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, would pass by a neighbor's house on a regular basis. Now, this particular neighbor was an older woman, and she didn't like him very much. Now, in order to demonstrate the fact that she didn't like him very much, every time he would pass by, she would throw trash, or garbage, I think you call it here, rubbish, over him, a basket full of rubbish over him, exactly as he passed. And he would know this. It happened more than several times. It happened on a regular basis. And he wouldn't say anything. He'd pass by, she would throw the rubbish, and he would continue on his way. One day, he passed by, and no rubbish was thrown. And he thought, oh, that's unusual. So inquired about what had happened to this lady, and somebody said, actually, she's very, very sick, and she's unable to leave her bed. And so he went to visit her. And she was quite startled, and thought, well, has he come to wreak revenge and wreak havoc upon my life now that I am an invalid and I can't really defend myself? But actually, he went to see how she was. And he went to, it's a very strong principle to inquire, in any good society, to inquire after the sick and the vulnerable. So he went to see how she was getting on. So to me, you know, the action that he faced and his response to it, you know, often when, in general conversations, when somebody talks about, well, you know, the Prophet, he would behave like this and he would behave like that, and I would actually carefully consider and ask people, especially my family, really, do you think that that's how we should behave? Can we think for a second, what would Muhammad do? So if we take that example, his response and his reaction in a very physical way was one of nurturing and one of caring. And so for me, that's a really important story, and it's a really important message. And then I just wanted to, this is a story that I found in a book that was written by Arsalan Iftikhar, an American. And it was published in 2011, and it's called Islamic Pacifism. And I came across this by complete accident in my research for today. And it tells a story of somebody called Abdul Ghaffar Khan. Abdul Ghaffar Khan, his story is being told by actually Gandhi's nephew at the moment. So the biography is being written, maybe it's been published by now actually. And the story is also being picked up by the New York Times and the Washington Post, and so it came to my attention. And he's renowned as the frontier Gandhi, because he was on the frontier as we know it across Pakistan and Afghanistan. During the British rule over what was then the whole of India. And he was a pacifist. And it came as much a surprise to me as it might to some of you in this room, because it was a particularly violent period when Hindus, Sikhs, and Muslims were retaliating against the empire and were strongly encouraging the empire, the Bush empire, to leave and to grant them independence again. And so to come across figures like Gandhi is a surprise, but it's well established in history. But then to come across Abdul Ghaffar Khan was even more surprising. And he spoke, he said, anybody who follows me has to swear that they shall never use violence, that they shall not retaliate or take revenge, and that they shall forgive anyone who indulges in oppression and excesses against them. Furthermore, for over two decades of his life, Ghaffar and his supporters dominated this northwest frontier province without resorting to violence ever. They endured prison and torture. Now, in response to this political campaign of Islamic pacifism, Abdul Ghaffar Khan's dear friend and the pacifist contemporary, Gandhi, once called Khan's non-violent political feat a miracle. In Professor Rajmohan Gandhi's biography entitled Ghaffar Khan, Nonviolent Badshah of the Pashtuns, one of the central theses of the important life history of this Islamic pacifist was the notion that to this Muslim, forgiveness was an integral part of Islam. So there's a whole story, I won't go into it now. Anybody who wants to learn more about it can easily Google it or look at the book Islamic Pacifism by Arsalan Iftikhar. And thank you for listening.
Thank you. And now we have Kanbar, Hossein-bor, also from England, but a...
Thank you very much for that introduction, and it's a pleasure to be here amongst very distinguished and learned colleagues. Insofar as my contributions here today, I suspect they'll be modest and mostly a product of my own personal reflections, both as a frontline policymaker on behalf of the UK, trying to grapple with some of these issues, but also insofar as my own personal experiences of someone being born in Iran and coming as a refugee to the UK and experiencing the plurality of ideas in that regard. Having had to try and browse through the 346 pages that were sent to us, the one message that I did take away from this book is that it's a very timely contribution, certainly during these difficult and pressing times. If I can quote Professor Sanneh, he says, "The history of Islam is at heart the process of negotiation and adjustment with other traditions and cultures, including the modern West." And if there's one message I do take away from this book and one contribution, which I think is essential, is the idea that Islam doesn't operate in a vacuum, far from it, that it's a product of interactions with individuals and the values that they carry. And in that regard, it reminds us that it's an ongoing process, an ongoing negotiation. And this message, I think, is really crucial because, as we all know, outside the bubble of this established and esteemed intellectual bastion, there are other narratives out there, other dangerous narratives out there about Islam and its relationship with the West. Consider the following, for example. We've got Abdul Manap Mentang, a young Filipino man who is suspected of carrying out a serious terrorist attack in Davao City. We've got Abdullah Qalsar Khan, a Pakistani man who is suspected of carrying out a terrorist attack in Medina, of all places. We've got Mir Sameh Mubasher, a young man in Bangladesh, who is suspected of carrying out the awful attack a couple of months ago in the cafe in the capital. We've got the Kouachi brothers in France of Moroccan background who carried out the attack against Charlie Hebdo. We've got Michael Adebolajo and Michael Adebowale in the UK who were involved in the murder of a British soldier. And finally, we heard a couple of days ago, or 2 days ago here, we have a Dahir Adnan, a Somali-American who suspected of carrying out a knife attack. We've got young men of different races in different continents all carrying out serious terrorist attacks. And the narrative that this feeds is a very simple narrative. The idea that what unites all of these is that they are Muslim. And how is it that these men with differing backgrounds can carry out such attacks. And therefore, the message that we're getting today about Islam not being in a vacuum, but being part of a larger process, to me, is essential. And as someone who has served in Baghdad and been responsible for the UK foreign policy on Libya and worked and done other activities in the Middle East, I can, with my own experiences, rebut those suggestions very easily. Because when I was trying to grapple with how is it that the UK can help make a difference in Libya, or what were the challenges that were taking place in Iraq, as all of you will appreciate, we didn't sit around on a table and think to ourselves, the problem is Islam. How do we solve Islam? Far from it. My own personal experience of that revealed to me this idea that there is a crisis of legitimacy taking place in many of these very difficult countries and these difficult situations. And it's very natural that during these very difficult times, people are going to look for normative reference points which can provide a degree of confidence. And I think one of the byproducts of the virtue of globalization is the increasingly contested space of ideas, and coupled with our short attention spans, means that we are gravitating to the loudest and the most provocative voices in any genre. And as we have seen, Islam is no exception to these, and it seems to be the most susceptible. Because when we are faced with this crisis of legitimacy, when we are faced with who's going to fill the vacuum, from my experience, we've got people who are using Islam and a very base form of it to espouse their political ideologies, which is something Professor Sanneh touched upon, insofar as the toxic and corruptive relationship between power and politics and Islam. So looking ahead, for me, the real challenge is this idea of the dialogue. And I was struck by the comments of Professor Sanneh on the ulama and the idea of civil society and dialogue taking place within the Muslim community. Of course, that makes a lot of sense. And that should be encouraged. However, for me, the one thing that I'm struck by is that if we take the idea that Islam doesn't operate in a vacuum as important and serious, then to me, what's even more impressing and more important is the dialogue between communities, not just within Islam. I've heard some people say that the problem, or the so-called problem within Islam, is something that only Muslims can deal with. They have the legitimacy and the standing to engage in these processes, these ideas. And consequently, there will be an organic solution. Maybe some people refer to a reformation of sorts, and that's where the solution will be. To me, I think that's an antiquated way of thinking. And if we take the message from Professor Sanneh's books and others, that Islam doesn't operate in a vacuum, I think it's incumbent upon all communities to be engaging in a dialogue with one another and influencing one another. Because the practice of religion, and certainly the practice of Islam, is not just abstract religious pronouncements, but also what's really important is the human interface of the individual implementing and carrying out these obligations. And those individuals, again, are a product of our society. Obviously, this dialogue needs to be done with a degree of respect, a degree of understanding, a degree of empathy. But I think what's important and what this book is demonstrating is that given the right circumstances, there can be a mutually beneficial exchange of ideas between Islam and other social cultures. So I want to applaud Professor Sanneh for this very timely contribution. And I hope that going forward, this and many other voices can be used to contest a very powerful negative narrative which seems to be going stronger by the day. Thank you very much.
Thank you both. And now I think I open the floor. We have to unfortunately end at 6 o'clock sharp, but we do have some time for questions and comments from the floor. Yes, sir.
Lamin, I can't wait to read your 364 pages, which I think it sounds like you've really done some really important research in the documents, which we haven't been had access to. I have to say I'm a little bit of a skeptic because I've written on this subject in West Africa, and I've been witness to the most horrific aspects of Islamic Jihad in West Africa. And so I wonder, that was in the 20th century. So we're talking about a whole different era, of course. But these were perpetrated by the Malinke in Guinea. And I just wonder a couple of things. The documents that you use, of course, I'm sure we don't have the testimony of ordinary people and how they were affected by the Islamization of the Malinke. So that's one thing. Second, as you know, there was a sharp division between the Malinke and what became the Bamana or the Bambara. And so I think this needs explanation because this is a very severe rift. And why was it so severe? And why were the Bamana ostracized? And this is a very large group, practically half of the Manding peoples. And so how does this figure in? One has to wonder, we don't know what went on in the 13th century, 14th century. How did they come to such severe odds with each other? So for these reasons, I have to be a little bit skeptical about the pacifistic introduction of Islam in that region.
Lamin?
Well,
he's a friend.
Yes, I mean, the pacifist tradition in Islam, as I said in the book again and again, is not a cure for jihad. But it does complicate the argument for jihad. And the examples I discussed in the book have to do, well, two major examples. One is the effort to convert the Fulbe or Fute Jalong and elsewhere by jihad. That really failed. And the coming of the clerics to Fute Jalong was at a time when Fute Jalong had been exhausted by the effects of the 18th century jihad movement. The other example I gave is of what I call a house divided. That there were radical clerics who embarked on warfare. But because they were aware of the fact that there was a pacifist tradition with a principal repudiation of jihad, they were very careful not to call their movements jihad. In other words, it complicated the idea that a Muslim warrior could embark on warfare at will and just call it jihad. The pacifist tradition, again and again I say in the book, is not an argument that jihad has not taken place in Islam. In fact, the photograph I showed you of that cleric, the only time he got agitated was when I reminded him that jihad was not so alien to the beginnings of Islam. And he nearly dropped his piece of paper and he said, yeah, but can you justify, can you explain in any way that jihad was beneficial to Muslims? And then he referred to the Sunni-Shiite split, and the, in his view, the scandal of Muslims shedding fellow Muslim blood. And I said, at that point, I said, I'm not challenging the tradition of pacifism. I'm only an investigator, and I like to tell you a story, so you tell it to me, and I will write it down. The final thing, though, I want to say about that is some of the most cogent arguments against jihad happened to be made by the foremost leaders of jihad, Usman Danfodio of North Nigeria, who wrote a poem in Hausa, one of the very few times he used the vernacular to write. He wrote a poem in Hausa called Wallahi Wallahi, by God, by God, in which he bemoaned the consequences of jihad, a jihad he launched himself. And he said, I swear by Almighty God that I've never accepted political office on the jihad, and I wash my hands of it completely. That's Danfodio, perhaps the greatest architect of jihad in West African Islamic history. Al-Kanimi, the Sultan of Bono, who studied in Cairo and Medina, was himself actually a scholar of jurisprudence, challenged the jihadists and said, you argue for jihad, but in arguing for jihad, you are burdening Muslims with inheriting a blemished heritage, because jihad is defensible intellectually only if you believe that there was a time when Muslims had a state of virtue. He said, can you point to me any time in history where Muslims lived in a state of virtue? Because he said Syria and Medina and Cairo and everywhere else in Islam, they violate ethical norms. There is sin everywhere. But that does not invalidate their Islam. And so to the jihad argument, Al-Kanimi responded by saying the only way you can redeem Islam from the blackmail of jihad is to accept that obedience is a matter of balancing. There will always be people who will fall below the standard. If you condemn them through takfir, you are really being unfaithful as a Muslim. So it seems to me that within the jihad itself, there were voices raised against the dangers of jihad. And the argument of Al-Kanimi that jihad has been more harmful to Muslims than it has been helpful to them. And I think you can say the same thing about radical violence today.
But is that the metric? I mean, jihad is not, you tell me, but jihad is not understood on all things considered, we're going to be better off. Jihad is motivated by a belief that this is God's will. I mean, that's not a calculation about all things being better. This is a divine, you're on a divine mission.
Yeah, well, clerics would argue that it is not God's will that Muslims should open themselves to violation of the ethical norms of Islam, of religion. They say, this is not God's will. This is Al-Ghazali's argument, by the way. That fitna, that is to say, anarchy, dissension, is not God's will for Muslims.
Right.
Or for the world. That is not God's will. And so this is exactly what the Sheikh Farouki told me in West Africa when I challenged him about jihad. And he said, you want to tell me that the spectacle of Muslims shedding fellow Muslim blood, you want to tell me that that is God's will? He said, no, that is not God's will. So jihad for these contemporaries became highly dubious morally. And the effects, they said, show that jihad was really ill-conceived to begin with. God's will for the Ummah, there's a tradition about the Prophet who said, on the Day of Judgment, many, many people would say, me, me, but the Prophet would declare, my community, Ummati, Ummati, my community. And it's the individual lone wolf who embarks on the path of terrorizing Muslims and embarking on jihad. That is not the will of God for the community. And Muslims would say, God created us for community. That's God's intention, God's will, that we live in society and in community.
Hi, my name is Sandra Sanneh. I'm married to Lamin Sanneh, and I want to tell a little personal story that is connected to this book. A long time ago, when Lamin and I were graduate students at the School of Oriental and African Studies, and were thinking about making our friendship into a longer-term commitment, he went off to do his research on the Jahanka, the clerics in West Africa, and invited me to come and visit him, to see him in his natural state, as he put it. So, I, having been born and raised in South Africa, somehow managed, I think it was because my brother-in-law, Lerman's brother, was working in immigration, somehow got me into the country. And he whisked me away from the capital and into this small inland area where he was based. And a few days later, he took me to visit several of these clerics that he had been interviewing. And for me, inexperienced young girl from South Africa, I'd lived in other parts of Africa, but this was my first visit to West Africa. It was very striking and very moving. I remember in particular a cleric by the name of Alhaji Madihawa, who, when we arrived at his compound, immediately told Lamin to sit outside, and he took me into the interior to show me the women's quarters, a place that Lamin was never permitted to go. And then when we asked to take his photograph, he pulled out a wonderful purple robe and some other locally woven cloths and set them up behind him so that the photograph of him makes him a very grand figure indeed. But for me, it was a very memorable journey being introduced to these men with whom Lamin was developing an ongoing relationship. And when his first book about them, which was his doctoral thesis, was published, I know that they were extremely moved by it. He went back and took copies to them, and they have since formed an organization of which they've made him an honorary lifetime member. So I just thought I'd share.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Professor Sanneh, the terms jihad and pacifism are sort of notoriously elastic. I have, some sense from context that you've been using it about what jihad is referring to. I'm actually a little more uncertain about why, and I haven't read the book. Why you use the term pacifism, because it sounds, to me, in practice, my competitiveness, it sounds like you're really talking about a reluctance, or maybe that's not a strong enough word, a commitment to try to avoid resort force or violence in matters of religious or normative difference. Mm-hmm. That is quite different from the way the term pacifism is often used in discussions of ethics of war and violence in a number of different philosophical and religious traditions. So could you say a little bit more to clarify your choice of that term?
Well, thank you very much. When I wrote the first draft of the book, I had a section in the early part of the book dealing with pacifism and the way it's used. And the reviewers of the manuscript felt that it was a little out of place, but that the subject itself and the way I was introducing it, they felt was important. So I removed it from the early part of the book and put it into a separate chapter of the book. It's an important distinction to bear in mind, what you're alluding to. And I've gone into it in some depth, I think, in the book to distinguish between the way I'm using pacifism in the Islamic clerical tradition and Western notions and discussions of pacifism and violence. A couple of things, just because it's a long section. A couple of things. These pacifists, these Muslim clerics, never rejected apostolic authority. And therefore, they never had the idea that they must reject society. That's a very important part of their thinking. The second is that pacifism in the West produce a kind of radical politics. And you see this with Roger Williams, for example, in Rhode Island, but also the Quakers in Pennsylvania. And Lincoln made the observation, he wrote to a Quaker friend, I think Lincoln has some Quaker background, I think, in his own life. He wrote to a Quaker friend to say, well, the Civil War has presented the Quakers with a terrible dilemma. Quakers obviously oppose slavery, and they also oppose, in other words, oppose oppression of slaves, but also oppose war. And he said, in his experience, the Quakers have had to choose one of two horns of the dilemma. And he said, many opted for oppression of war to end oppression, and others chose the other horn of the dilemma, which is a very subtle way of saying they have not really resolved the question, even in that tradition. The pacifists I deal with also tell a little joke to their own cost about this choice that you have to make as a pacifist faced with politics and war. And they put it into a story like this. The king has asked us and given us a choice about whether we should build him a castle or whether we should take up weapons and go to war. We have said that if he asks us to build him a castle, we shall build him a castle. If he asks us to take up weapons and go to war, we shall build him a castle. We are entirely at his disposal. Again, you see the problem there. So the Muslim pacifists I'm talking about have never rejected the idea of society, although these pacifists have rejected politics for themselves. They will not be chiefs or rulers. And believe me, they were tempted quite often with political spoils, but they said no. And they don't condemn politics. They say it's not compatible with the vocation they have chosen. But they would pray for the rulers. They will even try to minister to warriors. But they will not assume that office themselves. So I do encourage you to look at that chapter, where it's a very important discussion there about pacifism in the West and in the Islamic tradition.
I assume that the choice of the word pacifist was responsive to Kanbar. That is, you were trying to create the alternative narrative.
Yes.
And that was what the attraction, that was what the real attraction of the word was. I mean, what he's talking about, and this goes also to Kanbar's intervention, is kind of a process of negotiation, of engagement with the local culture, not sort of attempts to annihilate it, but rather to persuade the people from their starting points as to why they should become Muslim as opposed to adhering to the system of beliefs. So it's something like negotiation, engagement, but those words don't have the capacity, they don't have the capacity to create the counter narrative that Kanbar is sort of pointing us to. Lamin, let me ask another question that's related to that. One of the great themes of your work in general has been Christianity and translation.
Yeah.
That the distinctive, one of the distinctive aspects about Christianity is that it's, in a sense, a translated religion. And you talk about the contemporary Christianity, Christian missionary work of now being sort of adjusting to, what is it, 2,000 different languages or something like that. It's just sort of an amazing phenomenon. You also recognize that Islam is not of this translated variety. Islam is in the language of the prophet, it's Arabic, and this would seem to be a kind of stumbling block to the pacifist tradition. I mean, I think it's very difficult to understand of a kind of a missionary work that doesn't bend to the language there and insist upon that the sacred text could only be untranslated, has to be in Arabic. There's a very powerful movie out, you probably saw it on Timbuktu, which sort of dramatizes the incapacity to communicate when only one person in the entire community speaks Arabic and no one else. So when you talk about, in this book, when you talk about, you know, adaptation, negotiation, are you departing from your previous thesis about the unique capacity of Christianity to propagate through this process of negotiation? I mean, you previously drew a distinction, but when I'm finished with this book, it doesn't seem, the distinction doesn't seem quite as clear to me.
Yes. Well, behind it, one of the themes, one of the strands, there are many strands in the book, is Islam's encounter with African religions.
Right.
And that is expressed in the social pluralism of the Kingdom of Ghana, but also the Empire of Mali.
Right.
And many, many travelers in ancient Mali remarked on how different ethnic groups and different races existed quite amicably in an environment of mutual respect. Ibn Battuta was really struck by the seriousness with which Africans took Islam, but also their reputation for conciliation, for peace and moderation. He was really struck by that.
Right.
Here were these parents who sort of basically put their children through boot camp to learn the Quran in Arabic, and yet who would turn around and make sure that nobody was ill-treated or maltreated because they belonged to a different religion or different race or different ethnic group. And I do think that African background was an important way to renegotiate the untranslatability of the Quran.
That's true, but it seems to me that the untranslatability of the Quran always must oppose a barrier to the propagation of the religion through voluntaristic, pacifistic means. There's just one additional barrier. The sacred text is not accessible to the people of the community.
Well, and this is why these clerics establish their practices in villages. And in a way, you can see why. The state is not really able to dispense the Quran because the state is not conducted in Arabic.
Right.
And that immediately removes the state from any functional role in the dissemination of religion.
Right.
These clerics who study Arabic and are really scholars of the language also speak African languages.
Right.
I mean, I spoke to them. I use Arabic, but I also use actually African languages, and quite several African languages. And when they do exegesis of the Quran, they do it in an African language. Wolof, many of you are familiar with Wolof, is a wonderful vehicle for the Tijaniya Sufi tariqa. They do most of their preaching and exegesis in Wolof. Very few really are masters of Arabic, which removes the state from any function in the teaching and the dissemination of Arabic as such. So it does provide cover. More than that, it shows Africans that there is a language such as Arabic that you may not speak very well, but that becomes an oracle for religious purposes. And you can therefore separate that from other aspects of your life where you engage the culture. I think the classic example of
this. But it's an oracle that you can't understand.
Well, the classic example of this are the griots, the musicians. Their music is liberally sprinkled with Arabic phrases from the Quran. Mm. And they are masters of these musical instruments that they play. They are Muslims themselves. They go on pilgrimage to Mecca. But the music is not allowed in the mosque. It's not allowed in the mosque. So when they pray, they are Muslims. When they play, they are vehicles of the secular Manding tradition. And Mali, I think, has produced some of the most spectacular examples of this kind of Quran music and Balafon music. Tumani Jebate, for example, and many others who are really masters of this instrument. But Arabic, this is what I used to think, that Arabic inhibits the spread of Islam because it is a language of scripture and of worship and of devotion. I haven't found many examples of Islam retreating because of lack of knowledge of Arabic, where it has taken hold. I haven't found many examples of that. And so I've said, well, maybe Muslims understand that there are different ways of being religious. Arabic functions as a liturgical vehicle to carry your prayers to God, whatever. Christianity, on the other hand, is remarkable by the fact that Christians do not worship and pray and read the scripture in the language of Jesus. And in the United States, I have many friends in the South who say to me, because of my work in translation, if the King James Bible was good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for them. And I said, well, I hate to surprise you, but Jesus did not speak English. And that is the problem. In other words, the problem for Christianity is this translation has sort of fragmented it quite a bit. Whereas Islam's investment in Arabic has given it a cohesion and a coherence that
Muslims share whether or not they know Arabic. By the way, I was just looking at this issue a week ago from two of my teachers, Kenneth Craig, The Call of the Minaret, and Spencer Trimmingham, who wrote on Islam and Sufism, and also wrote on Christianity among the Arabs before Islamic times. And both of them came to the conclusion, so it's very hard to define who is a Muslim. The only way to proceed, if you're going to proceed at all, is to accept it when Muslims call themselves Muslim. Because on the level of abstract definition, it's very difficult to fit them into a category. The only way is to say, well, they call themselves Muslim, and I interpret that to mean they consider themselves members of the Ummah. Yeah? They consider themselves members of the community of faith, which forms their identity, although their practices and daily lives may be very divergent from what we understand as Islam.
I have to, you want to take the last question or?
Okay, quick question.
Sure.
I'm wondering how watertight do you think might the different Islams be? And partly, does language play into that? A corollary to that would be, could it be that the quote-unquote problem of the Arabs is that the sacred text is accessible to those who are practicing politics as well, as opposed to, say, West Africa, where you have that division?
Mm-hmm.
And so that leads a number of different directions, but I'll leave it there.
That's interesting. Let me thank the respondents for their comments. Let me thank Lamin for his comments and congratulate him on this beautiful book, which I must insist is only 299 pages. The rest is all footnotes. So, but it's a great achievement, Lamin. Congratulations.
Thank you.